A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu newspaper analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 4th of January 2022. First of all, I wish you all a very happy new year and all the very best for all of your future endeavors. On that happy note, we'll see the diverse list of articles that we have taken today for our discussion. First of all, we are going to see about the Russia-Ukraine issue. And after that, we are going to see some details about the non-proliferation treaty, that is the nuclear non-proliferation treaty. And after that, we'll be seeing some details about offline e-payments. Yeah, you heard me right. Offline e-payments. It's an interesting oxymoron, right? We'll see what they are later in our discussion. Coming back to the articles list, after this offline e-payments, we'll see some basic details about the unemployment and different types of unemployment. And finally, we'll see about Pangong So Lake and the significance of it for India. Without any delay, let's get into our article discussion. Take a look at this text and context article here. It talks about Russia's military troops who are continuously gathering at Ukraine. See, more than 1 lakh troops have gathered here. This Ukraine, it is an aspiring member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, which is nothing but the NATO. And aspirants, if you want to know about NATO, just take a look at our Hindu newspaper analysis video of December 28, 2021. See, the article mentions about Russia's proposals. And also, it talks about the responses of the Western countries like USA, Germany towards this move by Russia. We'll cover every aspect of this article in our discussion. But before that, the syllabus relevant to the article is given here for your reference. Please go through it. Now, let us get into our discussion. See, first of all, you should know the location of Ukraine. Where is it exactly? Look at these maps. You can clearly see that Ukraine shares borders with European Union countries and also with Russia. But as a former Soviet republic, Ukraine has deep social and cultural ties with Russia. Now let us have a brief background about this Russia-Ukraine conflict. Russia has long resisted Ukraine's move towards European institutions. When Ukrainians removed their pro-Russian president in 2014, Russia seized and then annexed the southern Crimean Peninsula from Ukraine, and Ukraine's two eastern regions, collectively known as Donbas, was captured by separatists backed by Russia. You can see the Crimean Peninsula here, and these are the two eastern regions that are captured by separatists. See, Russia's aggression in Ukraine has triggered the greatest security crisis in Europe since the Cold War. Though the United States and its allies have taken significant punitive actions against Russia during the seven-year-old conflict, they have made only a little headway in helping to restore Ukraine's territorial integrity. See, even at present, continuous buildup of Russian military forces along the border of Ukraine has created fears that Moscow is preparing for a large-scale invasion of its neighbor. But Russia has denied it. See, at a press conference, Russia's president has clearly stated that the troop deployment is in response to NATO's refusal to cap its eastward expansion. Though US and NATO had agreed for talks with Moscow, they had denied to take Moscow's proposals seriously. And also note that US President Joe Biden had assured his Ukrainian counterpart, Volodymyr Zelensky, that in case of an invasion by Russia, US will respond decisively. Thus, US and NATO insist that Ukraine and every other country has the right to determine its own foreign policy. So we saw that US and NATO had not taken the Moscow's proposal seriously, right? In this context, we'll understand what are those demands by Russia regarding this Ukraine issue. Russia's President Mr. Vladimir Putin said that non-invasion by Russia would depend on compliance with Russia's security demands. See, Russia released some demands in the form of draft security packs at a press conference in 2021 December. The foremost demand among them is that NATO should withdraw troops and weapons from all countries in Europe that joined the alliance after May 1997.
Why after May 1997? See, this was after the collapse of the Soviet Union, which happened in the year 1991. So what does Russia mean by this demand? By this, they mean that NATO cannot operate in any of the Baltic nations that border Russia, like Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, and also Central European states such as Poland, Hungary, and Czech Republic, and lastly, the Balkan states such as Croatia and Slovenia. The next important provision is that demanding NATO to stop its expansion towards the east. See, now Ukraine is aspiring to become a NATO member. This is also an eastward expansion of NATO, right? So by this, Russia means to say that NATO should not accept Ukraine and Georgia as members. There is one more demand, which is that NATO must not hold drills without prior approval from Russia in Eastern Europe, Ukraine and Georgia. Here, by drills, they mean military exercises. So, what all we saw so far? We saw about the location which is between European Union countries and Russia. And we saw a brief background on Russian-Ukrainian issue, which includes annexation of Southern Crimean Peninsula and the capture of Donbas area by separatists backed by Russia. And we saw some of the demands of Russia, which includes withdrawal of troops and weapons from all countries in Europe and demanding to stop the eastward expansion of NATO. And the final one is to not hold drills without prior approval from Russia in the Eastern Europe, Ukraine and Georgia. Moving on, now we'll try to understand how this NATO, that is the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, is helping Ukraine. It is very clear that NATO's Western military alliance is purely defensive. We'll discuss here how NATO members are helping Ukraine. Firstly, let us see about UK. UK is said to help Ukraine build two naval bases, one on the Black Sea and the other one on the Sea of Azov. Secondly, we'll see about the USA. US has sent anti-tank javelin missiles to Ukraine, and they also gave two US Coast Guard patrol boats to the Navy. So this is how the NATO members are helping Ukraine. So these moves by the NATO members show that even though Russia is adamant that it will not allow Ukraine to join NATO, Ukrainian President Mr. Zelensky is looking for a clear timeline for the alliance. See, it is up to Ukraine and 30 NATO member countries to decide when Ukraine is ready to join the alliance. And it is even more important to understand that Russia has no right to interfere in this process. And having said that, now we'll see how far and how will the Western nations help Ukraine. Firstly, the US. US has made it very clear that it is committed to helping Ukraine defend its sovereign territory. Now, a crucial question arises here as to how will US help Ukraine. See, the biggest tools in the West's armory appear to be the sanctions and supporting the Ukrainian military. But the US President Mr. Biden also stressed that deploying US troops unilaterally is not the ultimate goal of US. See, for this, Ukraine has replied that it is prepared to defend itself alone. Secondly, we'll see about the UK. British officials are considering an extension of defensive support. This was said by UK's Foreign Office Minister. And also, using the biggest tool, that is, threatening to disconnect Russia's banking system from the international SWIFT payment system. So by doing all these, UK will help Ukraine. Thirdly, let us see about Germany. It has threatened to prevent the opening of Russia's Nord Stream 2 gas pipeline, which is in Germany. Since the approval of this completed gas pipeline is currently being decided by the Germany's energy regulator, Germany's foreign minister has clearly mentioned that this Russia's Nord Stream 2 gas pipeline could not come into service if there is further escalation by Russia against Ukraine. And also note that in case of an invasion, the American State Department officials certainly will put sanctions against Nord Stream 2 gas pipeline. See, viewers, if you want to know more about Nord Stream 2 gas pipeline, see the Hindu newspaper analysis of date December 30, 2021. Moving on, now let us see the futuristic actions that will be taken regarding this Russian-Ukraine issue. See, senior officials from the US and Russia will hold talks in Geneva on January to plan for Russia's de-escalation. Also note that negotiations are planned at Organization for Security and Cooperation, that is OSCE, in Vienna. See, while Russia is expected to continue its dangerous policy in terms of its geopolitical goals, the American and the NATO officials have pointed out strong support to Ukraine. See, this behavior of Russia is strengthening the NATO's thought of not to take decisions affecting Eastern Europe without involving the countries concerned. So that is all about this article. With this, we have come to the end of our discussion. What all we saw today? We saw about the location of Ukraine, which is between European Union countries and Russia. And we saw about the Russia-Ukraine issue, the annexation of Crimean Peninsula, and the capture of Donbas area by separatists. And after that, we saw the demands of Russia in the form of draft security pacts. The first demand is to withdraw troops and weapons from all countries in Europe that joined the alliance after May 1997. The second demand is to stop the NATO's expansion towards the east, like accepting Ukraine as its member. The final demand is not to hold drills without prior approval from Russia. And after that, we saw how the Western nations will help Ukraine if Russia invades Ukraine. We saw what US will do and what UK will do and what Germany will do. US will give support to Ukrainian military and it will impose sanctions. UK will extend the defensive support and it will threaten Russia regarding Russia's banking system from international SWIFT payment system. And what Germany will do? Germany will hold the approval of Nord Stream 2 gas pipeline, which is very crucial for Russian economy. And we moved on to see the futuristic actions regarding Russian-Ukraine issue. So with these points in mind, let's move on to the next article discussion. Look at this article. This article is with reference to the global nuclear powers who pledged on Monday to prevent nuclear conflict. The possibility of the conflict is because of the recently escalated tensions between USA and Russia. And why is that? It's because of the deployment of the troops by Russia in the Ukraine border. And on the other hand, China has vowed to seize Taiwan. These two incidents have raised the concerns among the global powers. In this context, we'll learn about NPT and why India didn't sign NPT and its relevance today. See, NPT is nothing but the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, and it came into force in 1970. The NPT is a landmark international treaty whose objectives are threefold. The first one is to prevent the spread of nuclear weapons and weapons technology. And the second one, to promote cooperation in the peaceful uses of nuclear energy. And finally, the third one is the goal of achieving nuclear disarmament. So the first objective is preventing the use of nuclear weapons. Second one is promoting cooperations in the peaceful uses of nuclear energy, like for power generation. And the third objective is the goal of achieving nuclear disarmament. Moving on, the NPT is the binding commitment in a multilateral treaty to the goal of disarmament by nuclear weapon states. As of now, a total of 191 states have joined the treaty, including the 5 nuclear weapon states, which are China, Russia, US, UK, and France. It is very crucial to note here that India is not a signatory to the NPT. See, to achieve the goal of non-proliferation and to gain the confidence of the state parties, the treaty establishes a safeguard system under the responsibility of International Atomic Energy Agency. So what this agency does? The safeguard system, they are used to verify the compliance with the treaty through inspections conducted by the IAEA, which is nothing but the International Atomic Energy Agency. So through this safeguard system, what they are doing? They are inspecting the state parties whether they are following the treaty or not. And also, the treaty promotes cooperation in the field of peaceful nuclear technology and equal access to this technology for all state parties. So, if you are a signatory to NPT, so you have equal access to the peaceful nuclear technology available. These safeguards are in place to prevent the diversion of fissile material for weapons use. Now, we'll see the relevance for India. Earlier, India was excluded from the 1970 Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. Excluded in the sense it is not included as a nuclear power because India was said to be acquired nuclear weapons capability only after 1970. Those countries who acquired before 1970 were accorded the status of nuclear weapon states under the NPT. Those five countries include China, Russia, UK, US and France. So after this, India refused to sign the treaty because India feels that it is a biased legal instrument that divided the world into nuclear haves and nuclear have-nots. India believes that this treaty does not constitute or contribute to the development of customary international law. India also believes that it does not set any new standards or norms. Apart from this, India have a geographical constraint also, with surrounding neighbors like Pakistan and China, who are pursuing and restoring their nuclear power and weapons. India giving up on its nuclear power status would be like a suicidal mission. In this way, India became one of the four non-signatory countries, which includes Israel, Pakistan and South Sudan. Just know that North Korea signed the treaty initially, but later it has withdrawn. See, the global efforts towards nuclear non-proliferation appears to be strengthened by treaties like NPT. But it is important to assess and evaluate the effectiveness of the established systems. And it is also important to make necessary changes to improve the overall effectiveness of such mechanisms to succeed. Having said that, the success of the NPT in the future rests upon a number of considerations, including a neutral and indiscriminate mechanism. And a systemic shift is needed to make acquisition of nuclear weapons unattractive to all state actors. So with this, we have come to the end of our discussion. We'll have a quick recap. What all we saw today? We saw about the Treaty on Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, that is NPT, and it came into force in 1970. We saw the three objectives, which is to prevent the spread of nuclear weapons, to promote cooperation in the peaceful uses of nuclear energy, the goal of achieving nuclear disarmament. And we saw the five nuclear weapon states, which are China, Russia, US, UK and France. We saw about the safeguard systems under the responsibility of International Atomic Energy Agency, through which they check the compliance with the treaty. And we saw why India didn't sign the treaty. And finally, we saw the needed changes to be brought in the treaty to make it a successful mechanism. With these key takeaway points, let's move on to the next article discussion. Take a look at this article. This is with reference to RBI's approval of small offline e-payments to promote digital payments usage in rural areas. Yesterday, Reserve Bank of India, that is the RBI, issued a framework allowing offline payments up to ₹200 per transaction. And it is subjected to an overall limit of ₹2,000. In this context, we'll learn about the offline e-payments and its significance in today's discussion. See, first of all, what is an offline payment? An offline payment is a transaction which does not require internet or telecom connectivity. You can understand this easily from the name itself. See, under the offline mode, payments can be carried out face to face using any channel or instrument like cards, wallets and mobile devices. Now we'll see why RBI is promoting offline payment. Many times when people try to make payments using a credit or debit card, one finds that the payment is failing most of the times. This could be due to any reason, one of which is lack of internet connectivity. Apart from this, unable to establish connection with the payments platform could also be a reason. See, recently, India has witnessed a boom in sales of cheap smartphones and even cheaper data connections. In spite of this, internet connectivity is yet to reach many parts of the country. The latest available data from the World Bank showed that in 2019, only 41% of India's population had access to an internet connection. See, this is despite of having a boom in the sales of smartphones and data connections. Therefore, RBI's move to push offline payments is inclusive, as many customers without smartphones would be able to reap the benefits of digitization. Now we'll see how the offline digital payment is done. It can be made using cards and mobile devices. See, you should know that there are some authorized payment system operators. They can be banks or non-banks also. Some of the PSOs in India are National Payments Corporation of India, MasterCard, Visa, SBI, Delhi Metro Rail Corporation Limited, Razorpay Technologies, etc. These PSOs will provide offline payment solutions using cards, wallets or mobile devices for remote or proximity payments. We'll see an interesting example here. The NPCI, which is the National Payments Corporation of India, operates an offline payments platform called *99#. The platform works on the top of the UPI system and is available on all GSM-based feature phones or smartphones. Look at this picture here. It shows the payments options without connecting to the internet. See, this is the phone here. After dialing *99#, it directly shows you certain options. What are those? You can send money, you can request money, you can even check your balance, you can update your profile. You can see the pending request if you select option 5. You can see your transactions and you can set or even change your UPI pin if you select the option 7. Marvelous, right? Now we shall watch a video to understand how a digital payment is done using *99# without internet connectivity. Here comes the video for you. Okay, I found this video interesting. Did you guys? See, this video will help you get a clear picture of the concept. Now moving on to another example. Recently, Paytm also launched a tap to pay card through which customers could load money onto the card without the internet and pay the merchants by tapping the card on the merchant's terminal. See, with this RBI's push now, many players are expected to enter the offline e-payment services. Here in this discussion, we saw two examples and we are expected to see more in the coming year. And with this RBI's push, more players are expected to provide these services. So that's all regarding this article. With this, we have come to the end. Let's have a quick recap. What all we saw? We saw about the RBI's approval allowing the payments up to 200 rupees per transaction and an overall limit of rupees 2000, and we saw about offline payment, which is a transaction which does not require internet, and we saw about payment system operators and some examples of PSOs, and we saw why this offline payment system is significant. Because according to the latest data available, only 41% of India's population have access to internet connection. And we saw two examples. One is an example of National Payments Corporation offline payments platform, that is *99#. The other one is Paytm's tap to pay card. With these points in mind, let's move on to the next article discussion. See here, this article gives you detail about India's unemployment rate. According to the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, that is CMIE, India's unemployment rate has hit 4-month high. In November, it was 7% and it rose to 7.9% in December. See, the article also says that the economic activity is disrupted by the restrictions imposed due to the surge of Omicron cases. And this article also says that the urban unemployment rate rose to 9.3% in December compared to 8.2% in November. And the rural employment, it stood at 7.3%. So what we are going to do here is taking this article as a context and we are going to learn about the different types of unemployment. First of all, what is unemployment? The term unemployment refers to a situation when a person who is actively searching for employment is unable to find work. So that particular person is currently not working. That condition is called as unemployment. Unemployment is considered to be a key measure of the health of the economy. I have given here the definition of unemployment given by NSSO, which is nothing but the National Sample Survey Office. Please go through it if you want to know about the definition of unemployment given by the NSSO. See, the high rates of unemployment are a signal of economic distress, while extremely low rates of unemployment may signal an overheated economy. High rates in the sense, if unemployment is standing at 9%, then there are no jobs in the economy. If unemployment is at 1% or 2%, then the economy is being overwhelmed with jobs. Having seen that, now let us move on to see some of the types of unemployment. The first one is cyclical unemployment. It is nothing but the variation in the number of unemployed workers over the course of economic upturns and downturns. That is the economic expansion or recession. Unemployment rises during the recessionary periods, that is when there is no economic growth. Unemployment rate increases, which means the jobs are less, and the unemployment declines during the periods of economic growth. This means that the unemployment rate is decreasing, which equals to the job increase. So this is called as the cyclical unemployment. The second one is disguised unemployment. See, the unemployment prevailing in Indian firms are mostly disguised unemployments. Suppose a farmer has 4 acres of land and he needs only 2 workers and himself to carry out various operations on his farm in a year. But if he employs 5 workers and his family members such as his wife, children, to do the same work that is done by 2 workers plus himself, then this situation is known as disguised unemployment. Here, the productivity of the extra members is zero. So the disguised unemployment exists when a part of the labor force is either left without work or is working in a redundant manner such that the worker productivity is zero. It is also the unemployment that does not affect the aggregate output. An economy demonstrates disguised unemployment when the productivity is low, as we have seen before, and too many workers are filling too few jobs. So that's it about the disguised unemployment. We'll move on to the third one. The third one is frictional unemployment. See, this frictional unemployment occurs when people voluntarily change jobs within an economy. After a person leaves a company, it naturally takes some time to find another job. Similarly, graduates just entering the workforce add to the frictional unemployment. So it is nothing but the time period that is there between a person being unemployed and he getting the job. So this time period between these two elements is called as frictional unemployment. This type of unemployment is usually short-lived because anyways that particular person is going to get the job. And it is also the least problematic from an economic standpoint. Now moving on to the fourth one. The fourth one is structural unemployment. See, it is a longer lasting form of unemployment caused by the fundamental shifts in an economy and by various factors such as technology and competition. This kind of unemployment occurs because workers, they lack the required job skills. See, here the jobs are available, but there is a serious mismatch between what the companies need and what the workers can offer. We'll see an example so that you will understand clearly. See, examples of becoming structurally unemployed include production assembly workers being replaced by new technology that assembles the products with codes. And another example is the declining need for printing press workers due to the increased consumer preference for digital publications. So now you understand why it is a longer lasting form of unemployment, because the shift is from hard copies to preference for digital publications. So this trend is never going to reverse. So that is why this form of unemployment is a serious concern from an economic standpoint. And finally, we have here the seasonal unemployment. Seasonal unemployment occurs only during a part of the year. In sectors such as agriculture and tourism, production takes place only in certain seasons. Therefore, these sectors offer employment to the workforce involved only for a particular time period in a year. People engaged in such activities under these sectors may remain unemployed during the off season. Now let us understand this concept of seasonal unemployment with the help of an example. See, there are a few seasonal crops, that is the crops that yield only in a particular season. Example, rabi or winter crops. So farmers working for the yield of these crops would be seasonally unemployed during the other times of the year. That is during summer, during rainy season. That means when there is an off season, the farmers are unemployed as they do not get to work on the field for any other purpose. So that's it about seasonal unemployment. And with this, we have come to the end of our discussion. Let's have a quick recap. So what all we saw? We saw about the definition of unemployment, which is a person who is actively searching for an employment and is currently not working. And we saw that it is a signal of economic distress. And after that, we moved on to see about the different types of unemployment. The first one is cyclical unemployment. This coincides with the economic upturns and downturns. The second one is disguised unemployment. It is mostly prevalent in agriculture. Here, the productivity of the labor force is zero. It occurs when too many workers are filling too few jobs. The third one is frictional unemployment. It occurs when people voluntarily change jobs within an economy. It is the short-lived unemployment and it is the least problematic. The fourth one is structural unemployment. It is the long-lasting unemployment because it is caused by the fundamental shifts in an economy. That is by the shift from older technologies to newer technologies. And here there is a mismatch between what the companies need and what the workers can offer. There is the lack of required job skills. And finally, we saw about the seasonal unemployment, which occurs only during a part of the year, and it is mostly prevalent in agriculture, tourism. With these points in mind, let's move on to the next article discussion. Look at this article here. This is with reference to China constructing a bridge in eastern Ladakh. See, it connects the northern south banks of Pangong So Lake. The bridge will significantly bring down the time for Chinese troops to move between two banks from around 12 hours to a mere 3 to 4 hours. So in this context, we'll learn about the Pangong So Lake and its significance. See, the Pangong So Lake, which is one of the most famous lakes in Leh, Ladakh, derives its name from the Tibetan word Pangong So, which means high grassland lake. So means lake. Pangong Lake is situated at a height of almost 4,350 meter in Ladakh. It is the world's highest saltwater lake. Its water seem to be dyed in blue and stand in contrast to the arid mountains surrounding it. It extends to almost 160 kilometer. Note that 1/3 of the Pangong So Lake lies in India and the other 2/3 in China. Now let us see some details about the Pangong Lake. See, the Pangong Lake is known to change colors, appearing blue, green and red at different times. The change in sky color and the refraction at high altitudes causes this color change. Pangong So Lake lies closer to the center of the 826 km long disputed border in eastern Ladakh. So this lake is lying closer to the center of the disputed border between India and China. Pangong So Lake is a long, narrow, deep, endorheic lake situated at a height of more than 14,000 feet in the Ladakh Himalayas. See, endorheic is nothing but a landlocked lake. You can see the image of Pangong So Lake here. It is surrounded by land, or to be precise, mountains here. And now let's see an interesting fact. This is the place where the scenes of the movie Three Idiots were shot. We all enjoyed the scenery showed in that movie, right? That beautiful place have a lot of significance for India. See, this lake is an integral part of the geopolitical relation between India and China. The lake flows through the line of actual control of these two countries, that is India and China. The LAC mostly passes on the land, but the Pangong So is a unique case. Here, the LAC passes through the water as well. Look at this map here. This is the line which India climbs as the LAC, and this is the line which China climbs as the LAC. And this is the disputed area. In the past, there were many clashes happened in this region, but recently China blocked the patrol by India beyond the clash point 4. Just know this fact. And based on the article that we have taken today for discussion, in this lake only China is building a bridge to connect the north and south banks of the lake. See, the lake, it lies to the southeast of Leh and it is very closer to LAC. And we also saw that it is the region where the LAC passes through water. The brackish water lake freezes over in winter and becomes ideal for ice skating and polo. The legendary 19th century Dogra general Zorawar Singh is said to have trained his soldiers and horses on the frozen Pangong Lake before invading Tibet. See, by itself, the lake does not have major tactical significance. But what makes it important is that it lies in the path of Chuzul approach. See, it is one of the main approaches that China can use for an offensive into Indian-held territory. Ironically, Chuzul is one of the 5 officially agreed border personal meeting points between Indian Army and the People's Liberation Army of China for regular consultations and interactions between the two armies to improve relations. So it is assessed that China can use this Chuzul as an approach for an offensive into Indian held territory. Indian assessments also show that a major Chinese offensive will flow across both the north and south of the Pangong So Lake. See, the Chuzul is here. So if China completes the construction of bridge, then it can enter India from both the southern and the northern banks of the lake. Over the years, the Chinese also have built motorable roads along their banks of the Pangong So Lake. This is also a major concern for India. So we have finished seeing the significance of Pangong So Lake for India. They didn't show this aspect of Pangong So Lake in that movie. We saw only the scenery of the place. So with this, we have come to the end of our discussion. We'll have a quick recap. We saw the location of Pangong So Lake and its characteristics and its significance for India. With these takeaway points, let's move on to the next part of our discussion. Here, I have given some of the prelims questions for your practice. Today, I have given 4 questions, out of which 2 questions are previous year prelims questions. So, for those previous year questions, you are going to give me the answer in the comment section. And I'll solve the remaining 2 prelims questions. Okay, now let us take up this first question, which has been asked in the year 2015. Consider the following countries: China, France, India, Israel, and Pakistan. Which among the above are nuclear weapon state as recognized by the NPT? The given options are 1 and 2 only, 1, 3, 4 and 5 only, 2, 4 and 5 only, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So this is a very easy question. Go back to our discussion or try to recall what we saw in our NPT discussion. We saw that there are 5 nuclear weapon states recognized by the NPT. I'm not going to give you the names. Try to recall it and post it in the comment section. The correct option for this question. Now moving on. This question was asked in the year 2017. Consider the following statements. National Payment Corporation of India helps in promoting the financial inclusion in the country. And the second statement, NPCI has launched RuPay, a card payment scheme. So aspirants, please try to solve this question. If you have any doubt, you ask me, I'll address them. But please try to solve it on your own and post your answer. I'll tell you whether it's correct or not. Moving on to the third question. Consider the following statements. Statement 1, disguised unemployment, hyphen technology and innovation, structural unemployment, agriculture, cyclical unemployment, that is the economic growth cycle. So which of the following statements given above is or are correctly matched? So from our discussion we saw that disguised unemployment is prevalent in the agricultural sector. So if we find that the statement 1 is wrong, then we can easily arrive at the answer, which is nothing but option B, 3 only, because in all other options, statement 1 is there. If we eliminate statement 1, we directly arrive at the answer, that is 3 only. So here, the statement 1 is wrong. We'll see the statement 2, structural unemployment. Structural unemployment is a long-lasting unemployment which occurs due to fundamental shifts in the economy, that is technology and innovation. So here, these two statements are reversed. That is, the statement 1 and 2 are reversed. Statement 3, cyclical unemployment. It occurs with relevant to the economic growth cycle. That is, with expansion, the unemployment rate decreases, and with recession, the unemployment rate increases. So, the statement 3 is correct. So, for this question, the correct answer is option B, 3 only. Moving on to the fourth question, which of the following statements regarding Pangong Lake is correct? Option A, Pangong Lake is situated in Arunachal Pradesh. Is it right? No. Pangong Lake is situated in Leh, Ladakh. Statement 2, it is the world's highest freshwater lake. Is it right? No, because we saw in a discussion that it is a saltwater lake. So option B is also incorrect. Option C, Pangong So is an endorheic lake. We saw in our discussion, endorheic is nothing but landlocked lake. So this statement is correct because Pangong So is a landlocked lake. Statement D, 1/3 of the Pangong Lake lies in China and the other 2/3 in India. The statement is wrong because we saw that 1/3 is in India and the remaining 2/3 are in China. So the correct option here is option C.
Today, I have given only one mains question based on our article discussion. So, interested candidates, write it and post it in the comment section. If you have any queries regarding the articles, post that also in the comment section. I'll address them. So, with this, we have come to the end of the analysis. If you find the video useful, please like, share and comment. And do subscribe to the Shankar IAS Academy's YouTube channel for further updates. Thank you.